Hello and welcome. This is the Reason Roundtable, a podcast that will never need price controls because we have always been free. I'm Peter Suderman, filling in for Matt Welch, who is in Chicago drinking Molort, I think that's how you pronounce it, Molort, with all the libs at the Democratic Convention. And speaking of libs, today we have a very special guest. In addition to my usual companions, Nick Gillespie and Katherine Mangu-Ward, we are joined today by none other than everyone's favorite Hollywood Nepo baby, Ben Dreyfuss. Everyone say hello.
Howdy, Ben.
Thank you. Hi.
Happy Monday. Thank you so much for coming. We're going to start with a word from our sponsor here.
Before we continue with the Reason Roundtable, I want to tell you about today's sponsor, Lumen, the world's first handheld metabolic coach. It's a device that measures your metabolism through your breath. Then on the Lumen app, it lets you know if you're burning fat or carbs and gives you tailored guidance to improve your nutrition, workout, sleep, and even stress management. All you have to do is breathe into your Lumen first thing in the morning, and you'll know what's going on with your metabolism, whether you're burning mostly fats or carbs. Then Lumen gives you a personalized nutrition plan for that day based on your measurements. You can also breathe into it before and after workouts and meals, so you know exactly what's going on in your body in real time. I've tried it, and I've got to tell you, Lumen is a great tool for motivation and information. It's easy and it's fun to use, seriously. Your metabolism is your body's engine. It's how your body turns the food you eat into fuel that keeps you going. Because your metabolism is at the center of everything your body does, optimal metabolic health translates to a bunch of benefits, including easier weight management, improved energy levels, better fitness results, and better sleep. Lumen gives you recommendations to improve your metabolic health. And get this, it can also track your cycle as well as the onset of menopause, women, and adjust your recommendations to keep your metabolism healthy through hormonal shifts so you can keep up your energy and stave off cravings. So if you want to take the next step in improving your health, go to lumen.me/roundtable to get 15% off your Lumen. That's lumen.me/roundtable. And you'll get 15% off your purchase. And now back to the Reason Roundtable.
Okay, Ben, thank you so much for being here. So normally we start the show with like a little rundown of what's going on in the news. But the big news, as far as I'm concerned, is that you are here on the Reason Roundtable. So we are going to start with a segment that I'm going to title Been There, Done That.
No.
So for listeners, yes, that's the title.
Stop.
I get to decide. So for listeners who may not know who Ben is, he is a former social media guru for Mother Jones, figured out what the kids liked on the internet. Today, he writes a fantastic Substack newsletter called Calm Down. You should all subscribe, even if you are the sort of person who likes the West Wing. He also maintains a very funny Twitter feed. And yes, he is the son of the guy from Mr. Holland's Opus, a movie I had to watch every single time that my middle school band director was out for the day. So Ben, very good to have you. I'm a big fan. I don't think we've ever talked in person, so it's just great to have you here. But I want to start by trying to kind of clear up something about you and your presence here and this show. So you understand that this is like a libertarian podcast, right? where the libertarians discuss the news, and you're a liberal or something, right? Like you worked for the magazine that that Michael Moore ran for a little while. So why are you here?
Well, right? First
like
off,
why is the Michael left... Moore guy here? Defend yourself.
He left on very bad terms. Okay, that was not the same.
So
one
did guy. You?
Well, that's they kind of supported the Sandinistas and things like that in you know the 70s. I was red pilled by your magazine, basically. You guys, there was one very specific
thank you
I read.
Yeah, I want to ask you about this.
But also, Matt, I went on the Fifth Column and they all started talking about, you know, all of these crazy things about maybe the too much regulation and things and libertarianism, and I was like, there has been a little more stuff going on at Mother Jones and like in the left that I'm uncomfortable with. And basically, for a long time, when I first got into journalism, I was just a good little liberal who had, I have like an FDR tattoo on my back, you know, I was a 2008 Obama bot, and I still am in my heart, but when I first got into political journalism, I was just, you know, kind of a robot just doing all of the things. And about 4 years into the job, when I had like been promoted and had been editing stories for a while, I probably should have started this earlier, but I became sentient and started to be like, I think fracking is good though.
That's really bad when that happens in the movies, usually.
Yeah, exactly.
when they become sentient. Like that's the moment that leads to the apocalypse. So
I think that's what happened to all of them. And they were like, we need to kill it. Unplug the robot. The robot is doing too much. And so then I was red-pilled by all of you, and now I am slightly more libertarian than I once was.
So do you classify yourself as just as like an almost libertarian, as a liberal, as a neoliberal? Do you have some very special word for yourself that no one else gets to use?
I have lots of special words for myself that no one else gets to
use. That's appropriate for this all family right. podcast, I guess.
But no, I mean, I used to just call myself I used to think I was a liberal, like a liberal progressive, then progressive became communist, I think. And now I'm a normie lib, is what I normally call it, but like a centrist person, centristy close. I would probably be a neolib to 90% of the people on the internet. When it comes to regulations, I'm increasingly libertarian.
Okay,
so you're in the culture, I'm increasingly libertarian.
Okay, so you're increasingly libertarian, but you're not a full-on libertarian yet, and you still identify as a normie lib, which is a species of lib, right? So where is it, why are you not a full-on libertarian? Where is it that you disagree with us, or you think, like, you still can't get on board with, like, those crazy guys from Reason?
Well, that's not really fair. I do think that you guys intellectually make lots of good points. One of the reasons not to be a libertarian is because the Libertarian Party in America is not, as you guys have covered very well, you know, it's sort of, and also there aren't enough libertarians for this to be a meaningful thing. You know, like there's not, you guys aren't going to be winning any elections anytime soon. You guys are the margins here.
Wait, so you're saying we're right, but we're losers?
Yeah, exactly.
Beautiful losers.
You can't sell the sizzle if you can't sell the steak, you know? Like, there's got to be something.
I expect more from a social media genius than you can't
well,
sell the
sizzle. Well, the thing is, my social media genius was figuring out how to game Facebook. It wasn't originally, like, winning it on the merits. It was that I found a way of exploiting it, and that's how you win in America.
I feel like you're going to have an awful lot to say about the Kamala Harris economic agenda if, like, your specialty is not winning on substance, but in fact gaming things and figuring out how to exploit, like, little tricks to get people to support you. But before we get to that, I do actually, we've got you on the hot seat here. And so I want to give my co-panelists just a quick opportunity to ask you any question on the record. So let's start with Katherine. What do you want to ask Ben Dreyfuss?
I guess since you're there at the DNC, I will ask you which substance is most important for surviving the week, legal or illegal?
Oh, no, I was joking. That was a joke.
We don't do those here.
Adderall, probably. It's Adderall, you know, it's flowing in the water now, probably. Normally the water in Chicago is green, but now it's dark blue.
So you're really mad at the government for causing the Adderall shortage?
Well, it's a 10 milligram Adderall tab.
Yeah, I mean, I was in
his my blue.
Doctor, my, like, I had, when I was flying here on Friday, my doctor, like, I couldn't fill the prescription until Saturday because they say, like, you know, it's a 28-day rule. And the pharmacist said, all right, just have your doctor call. And I called the hospital and the doctor was on vacation. And I started to be like, oh my God. And I went to increasingly absurd lengths and started to, like, use the fact that I was going to the DNC, and I was like, look, this is an emergency. I am going to where they're nominating Kamala Harris and everything, and I live in the one blue part of Idaho. So they were all on board. The entire St. Luke's like hospital system, they sent me to like a pediatrician who prescribed it, and then I got a call from the ER doctor who was like, we can get this done, just make sure, tell Kamala that at least 5% of Idaho is rooting for her. I had never said I was gonna actually meet her or anything like that, but I let them think it, you know. I did that thing that Tim Walz did with his military service, you just leave it open. So anyways, and a long answer to your thing is the Adderall that I got from a child pediatrician.
I'm glad that they were able to, like, call the all dog alert there and make that happen. Nick, what is your question for Ben?
Ben, I have a lot of questions to ask about your father, but we'll shelve that for a different moment. What was the role of increasing intensity of identity politics in pushing you away from the left, particularly after something like October 7th? It seems like you are in a place of a lot of former progressives who suddenly, at a certain point over the past year, looked at the left and said, you know, if that's what being a progressive is, I don't really want to be that. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that that was a long time coming. That was the sort of original thing that I had with the left, was about 10 years ago when this really started to pipe up with social media. You know, we had it the relevance of all of this came up more. There was more initially, like, you have, you know, base priority, like, feelings about all of the stuff that you agree with. But then as it became more and more central to all of it, it kind of, I found it antagonizing. And that's what led me to really in 2020 leaving, getting canceled from Mother Jones, was that I, you know, thought that it was okay that the New York Times published that story, and thought that, you know, defunding the police didn't sound very good. And then you antagonize people along the way of that. And then, of course, this all did last October with, like, the nail, you know, the period on the sentence, really, like, this long evolution of it, where you found people sort of moving to Substack and moving to Reason and moving to things like that from this world that had been sort of this liberal media that was sort of, I think, was a little more Obama era than post Obama era, maybe, is one way of looking at it. That it really, like, I was disgusted by October, the way the left responded to October 7th. It sort of, like, broke my heart and sent me away from them in a way that, like, won't be able to be bridged ever again, you know? Before, it was just sort of like, we had mean words because I liked Hillary and they liked Bernie. But this time, I was like, I just thought it was so bad that they refused to empathize at all immediately afterwards, on October 7th and October 8th, with Israelis who were, like, dealing with the terror attack. And it was a heartlessness that I just hadn't, I knew it was there because everyone has Jesus and Hitler on their shoulder, but, like,
the same shoulder.
Yeah, exactly. That's the Jews. We're the ones saying they're on the same. Yeah, I do think that that's happened, and then it slowly pushed it away. But then at the same time, I mean, I think that, you know, it's all complicated, but it is a, I went to the RNC last month, and, like, I didn't really have anything interesting to say. Like, I didn't have any interesting, I had, like, takes on, like, what it looked like and the weather and things like that. But I had a hard time getting my blood up because, like, I'm not a Republican. You know, it wasn't for me. It wasn't something I'm invested in. I'm deeply invested in the Democratic Party not being stupid. And when it does do stupid things or stupid members of its coalition, it hurts me the way that, you know, the most painful thing in the world is betrayal, right? And it's sad that that always happens when you feel like you're on these things. And, you know, it's internecine and everyone does it to each other. But it's that's why I hate the left now and complain about them constantly.
All right. So, speaking of Democrats being stupid, let's go to our next segment, which I'm going to call Price Gouging My Eyes Out. On Friday, Kamala Harris gave her first major economic policy address, where she called for, among other things, aggressive enforcement of price gouging in the food and grocery sector, subsidies of up to $25,000 for qualified first-time homebuyers, reinstatement of the child tax credit that was briefly in effect during the first part of the Biden administration, and she has also endorsed an idea from her opponent, Donald Trump, no taxes on tips, who says bipartisanship is dead. Katherine, which do you like more, price controls or subsidizing demand?
Yeah, thank you so much for those excellent options, Peter and Kamala Harris, I guess.
Don't blame me. I'm just the messenger.
The subsidizing demand piece of it makes more political sense to me. And I don't think that that's saying much. But hey, America, this thing feels expensive to you. Here's some money to spend on it. Is at least a format that we have followed in the past, disastrously in every case. But the good morning, your Campbell's soup cost has gone up a quarter, and don't worry, President Harris is on it and will be punishing the grocery chains is, you know, I think quite rightly was greeted as a further bridge, as something that we don't do as a matter of habit. And I don't know if you've been following Katherine Rempel, I don't know how you say her name, the
economics
Post,
columnist at the
Washington Post, economics
Washington
gal.
Post, yeah.
She wrote a piece with a truly fabulous headline, which was something like, hey, if you're being accused of being a communist, maybe don't propose price controls. And the whole internet left was like, how dare you? And then when Harris gave her economic speech and backed off of a bunch of what, you know, were originally pitched as price controls and started to sound a little more like antitrust.
So Catherine, are we sure that it's she's actually backing off, or did she just
sure
not
nothing.
Say did
we
she
know
just
nothing?
I mean, so this is a question I have is people have described this as backing off. But I think what you are saying is just that there was the proposal as described in the pre-release documentation before the speech was stronger and clearer than the words she said in her speech, but she's still not answering questions about what the actual proposal is.
Oh no. Yeah, absolutely. But I do think even there, you know, so she said a bunch of stuff that sounded more like, well, if prices are up because of collusion, that's already against the law and we'd punish that or something. And then Katherine Rempel said, okay, well, there was still a lot of silliness in the speech, but maybe she backed off it. And then in her Twitter mentions is everyone saying, like, how dare you call her silly? She's our queen. You know, so it's lose-lose. It's the whole discourse has gone totally off the rails. But if you're going to make me choose, I guess I choose demand setup subsidies over price gouging punishment.
So, Nick, as Catherine mentioned, one of the defenses of the price gouging policy has been that, well, actually, it's not really price controls, as some of the initial reports may have suggested. Instead, you know, it's really just aggressive antitrust enforcement. And anyway, many of these states have price gouging laws on the books already, and they don't really get used or cause big problems. But then there's another defense, which is it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter at all, because she's just doing what she needs to do to win the election. These are popular ideas. This is popularism, the sort of the brand of moderate Democratic politics that we have been hearing about for the last couple of years, which is just emphasize the stuff that people like. It doesn't even matter if it's real. That seems kind of cynical or nihilistic, or at least very shallow to me, right? Like, don't people hate politicians who just say anything to win? It seems to me like we're now seeing that as a defense. Oh, she'll just say anything to win. And because Donald Trump is the opponent, you know, that's what she's going to do. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it's a real shame that she's up against somebody who is a real nerd about policy and details and things like that. So obviously, yeah, it's not going to match up well. It's also great to think about, you know, what she is arguing for in talking about bringing grocery prices down. If it's not price controls, it's not going to work. It also, you know, an added irony to all of this is that she was announcing this literally on like the 50th anniversary or thereabouts of Nixon announcing price controls. So it's like this is just price controls are a bad idea. They don't work. Everybody understands that, except for Kamala Harris. And then she was able to kind of pivot a little bit on that. I think it's a failure. Her idea about, you know, the $25,000 for qualified first-time house buyers, you know, the people who need it are the unqualified homeowners. If you qualify for a loan, you have backing for it and stuff
so
like that.
So the qualification that I was referring to is that you have to have paid your rent on time for 2 years.
No, I understand that. But what I'm saying is that generally speaking, if you're paying your rent on time or if you can pass a credit check, and it's already, there are so many home ownership policies in place that are expansive. The first house that I bought, and this is many years ago, but two college professors had gotten an FHA loan where they only had to put down like 2% on a house that cost $130,000. So you figure out it is, you know, the problem with home ownership is not that it's beyond the reach of everybody. There is this dream that everybody wants to own a house in their 20s. When I read stories about Gen Z people feeling, you know, saying, I'm not going to be able to afford a house for 10 years. It's like, no fucking shit. You're 21 years old. What do you expect? And then that's all built on a broader edifice of the idea that the only way you can be fully participating in American bounty is by having a mortgage, which is just completely wrong. And I say that as somebody who, you know, I was in my 30s when I bought my first house. I am in my 60s, and I hope that I never own a house again. So I have a lot of sympathy, and I have a lot of experience in all of this kind of stuff. What I do find interesting about Harris's rhetoric, although it's as shallow and shitty as Trump's, is she's talking about the opportunity economy. And in that, she is channeling nobody other than Newt Gingrich, who talked about a conservative opportunity society back in the 80s, which was demeaned as basically taking big government liberalism and masking it in conservative rhetoric, as well as George Bush, who talked about the ownership society. These are it is a conservative concept to say what we're going to do is give people more opportunity, more ownership in America. And then the details matter, because what Kamala Harris has proposed so far, which is very vague, is antitrust. I mean, she's going to block Kroger and Albertsons, the fourth and fifth largest grocery chains, from becoming the third largest grocery chain, because that will help people somehow by blocking them, keeping that keeping that from happening. And, you know, she's against school choice. School choice is the greatest thing for poor people in America, lower income people. If you want people to be able to participate fully, you want kids to be able to go to schools that actually reflect the values of their parents and might teach them something. So she has not come out with any details that are going to assuage people. And the more she talks, the more gaseous and useless I think this whole feint is going to be seen as.
In her economic policy speech, she specifically said that the grocery price gouging rule was needed to promote competition, which is just crazy because the grocery sector is incredibly competitive. Profit margins in 2023 were something like 1.6%. That's how you can tell that it's competitive, is there's no room to raise prices, right? They raise prices when their costs go up, but they are not raising prices just because they're greedy and there's profit available. It's an incredibly competitive sector, because if eggs are too expensive at one grocery store, you go across the town, there's another one, or there's a Walmart, and you buy your eggs there. So Ben, I want to ask you what you think of the Harris agenda. Does this warm your YIMBY red-pilled heart, right? The one thing I didn't mention here is she is promising to incentivize the creation of 3 million new homes, which she says have to go to sort of normal middle class home buyers, however it is she defines that. And part of that, she says, is that she wants to cut red tape, barriers to building. But then her advisors have also told the New York Times, well, there's $40 billion worth of tax incentives that we're going to throw at this. So it just sort of seems like another kind of big spending program. How do you see this? Does any of this make you even a little bit happy?
I mean, overall, it makes me very unhappy, and I wish that she had never done any, never had stayed away from on just say weird over and over again and talk about abortion. But because this is the wrong meat on the bone. I feel like the price gouging stuff is all just nonsense. A few months ago, back when Biden was losing and he was going to be the one who lost, I remember that there was the greedflation thing, and I wrote a post saying that it'll be fake and stupid, and we in the media will call it out, but they should probably just blame the money-hungry fat capitalists at the Albertsons company or whatever it is, so that people will just get off with it. And I still think, like, to what you guys are saying, like, there's a political... I understand this is what some stupid people want to hear, and that's okay, but also the entire reason, it's one of the reasons it's okay is so that we can all come on a podcast and talk about how bad it is. It's creating an economy of commentary here. It's very stupid and awful, and I wish he hadn't done it. And in a world where they could actually accomplish it, I would be very upset about it. But they won't accomplish it. The one good thing is the reducing red tape. And I mean, I would even be fine with the $40 billion in tax subsidies if it's done right to get people to actually build multi-housing things. I think that the tips thing is her running after Trump's dumbest ideas. It's very it's validating them in bad ways. I think that it's not a good policy agenda.
But it doesn't matter if it's a good policy agenda. It just matters if people like it, right? Isn't this the argument? This is what people want to hear, and this is what it takes to beat Donald Trump. And you told us you went to the RNC. You didn't have anything in common with these people. You like when the Harris campaign, or Tim Walz calls Donald Trump weird. So do you sort of give her some sort of a pass here?
I give some sort of a pass, but here's why I guess I don't give more of a pass. I actually don't think this is that popular. I don't think it's going to be unpopular. I don't think people are going to care that we don't like it, and that they're going to see all the economist Twitter who's losing their minds about all of this. That's not going to matter. But
love
I also
economist
think
Twitter.
That, yeah, I just don't think
all
like,
powerful.
It's not going to hurt her, but like I also don't think that saying this stuff is going to move these polls very much, and I don't think like you would really expect to see it because I was never utterly convinced that you know people were actually upset about the cost of DoorDash. I think that was just a way of explaining larger problems that they had, and I have not seen anyone in the entire universe, and I'm sure they might exist somewhere in a left-wing magazine or something like that, who has actually like claimed any of this would be doable or successful. You know, even everyone in the New York Times has been going, oh, well, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, that is like we talk about that. And I unfortunately think that's going to be the theme of a lot of our election discussion on this podcast is like, we're in the era of policy nihilism. Like you just say words, they float off into the ether. Is it constitutional is not a relevant question. Could it be done with the current composition of Congress is certainly not a relevant question. Like, will this even be remembered in late January by whoever wins? Like, no, no, and no. I do feel like the tax on tips thing could be an exception to that. Like, not that it doesn't come from all the same stupid places, but like, people kind of heard that. And I do think people kind of like that one. And it's such a classic example of like, as you say, this is something idiots like. Like, oh my God, yeah. Sometimes people give me a tip and it would be cool if I didn't pay taxes on that is the beginning and end of the thinking there. I do look forward to compensating all of Reason's freelancers exclusively on a tipped basis. But
Substack, we're all going to go to OnlyFans. It's going to be a complete change.
Substack is going to have to convert. Yes, exactly. Is going to have to convert payments into tip your writer, right? Yeah. It's just going to be amazing how much,
you know,
how much income is going to be converted to tips if that goes into effect, right, whether it's through Harris or under Donald Trump.
You know, the other thing that is disturbing to me is just that neither Harris nor Trump are even pretending to try to win over the great mass of independent voters or non-committed voters. So that, you know, Trump, we've talked about this at the RNC. He started his speech in a very conciliatory, like, I want to be the president for all people. And by the end of it, which was, you know, 3 or 4 days later, he had a full beard by the time it ended. He was, you know, going through the phone book exactly
wrong with
why
that.
He hated this person, that person, and this person. And Harris is not, and certainly Tim Walz, who, you know, is like Tim Kaine, who is playing harmonica somewhere running for re-election. Tim Walz, after Harris loses, or even if she wins, he's going to disappear into the background, just like he always has been. But like his whole thing is to say anybody who likes J.D. Vance or votes Republican is weird and is weird, you know, don't even think about them as American. Like, where, you know, it just seems to me if you are part of a major party where you have 30% market share, basically, and the rest of people are independent, and you're not even trying to say, I want to speak to you, that person. I know you don't trust me and you don't trust my party and you're right to, but here are 3 ways I'm going to make your life better rather than pay homage to the people who are going to kick my ass if I become a little bit more centrist from either the right or the left. It's unbelievable to me. You know, that our political rhetoric at this point is all about how do you harden and sharpen the base and get, you know, a higher percentage of fewer and fewer people to come out to vote and then lie about who won or stole the election.
You know who did that at the RNC? That little twist. It was Nikki Haley. It was like sad, lonely, broken-hearted Nikki Haley was like, hey. Just
did you really just like feel her vibe at that moment?
I always feel her vibe. I don't like her policies, but man, I feel her vibe. Like she's tired the same way I'm tired. And she's just like, guys, a reminder that half of the country at the
you've already got the base. You need somebody base plus.
Is not already convinced. Sorry, Ben.
I mean, I feel like the general thing that you've just described is what's wrong with American politics increasingly, right? And it's not helped by small donors and the internet and all of this stuff where people feel this constant pressure to run to the extremes. But also then like you have the longstanding like problem, right? With and like why the Republican Party has become extra dysfunctional in the last 10 years is because like they realized, you know, with Donald Trump and a little bit before, I guess, that like Donald Trump could win without trying to get 51% of the popular vote, right? Like, you know, Mitt Romney tried John McCain tried, George W. Bush did the second time, you know, like they all had things that pulled them to the center a bit, that gravitated them towards it. And like, that's why all of this is supposed to work. Like when they don't do that, the whole system sort of breaks down. And the Democrats increasingly have also sort of like, you know, been looking for ways to maybe like they could just do this base mobilization nonsense that hilariously, like, as you said, like everything is based around, but also like is a theory that has been somewhat debunked in the last few years, you know, that, like
it certainly really didn't help Hillary, you know, Hillary got 49% of the vote. She didn't.
Like the theory that has, you know, activated the left and liberals for so long was always like, oh, you know, we're going to get the non-voters to vote. And then communism will be here by choice, everyone, because when the dock workers finally go to vote, and then Donald Trump, the person in history who gets people to vote who have never voted before, showed that actually what happens is an equal number on both sides vote. And nothing changes, but everyone is now madder and meaner. And the annoying 20% of people in America who talk about politics had become the annoying 40% of people in America who talk about politics. The other 60% all had to shoot themselves.
So just to kind of wrap all of this up, the top story on the New York Times website this morning had a headline that read, Harris's early campaign, heavy on buzz, light on policy. And the opening paragraphs described how Hillary Clinton, when she ran for president in 2016, had more than 200 different policy proposals. And when Joe Biden ran for president, he had a 110-page policy document. And Kamala Harris does not even have one single policy page on her campaign website at all. I think that tells you a lot about the Harris campaign and her strategy and how serious a lot of these proposals are, which is, say, not very serious at all. The other thing that story makes clear is that a huge amount of what she is doing is simply reframing Bidenomics. She is taking the Biden approach to the economy, which Biden, you know, toured the country calling Bidenomics, bragging that it was all him and that it was great and it's all these ideas. She's not using that word, but it is fundamentally the same approach of just like throwing money at stuff that you think is good, enforcing antitrust aggressively where you can, or saying you're going to try to, and then hoping that is going to sort of build the liberal coalition and keep it together without really making any attempt to reach out to other folks who might not be with you. So I think that wraps things up here. But all of this, of course, is a good lead-in to what we are about to experience here, which is the Democratic National Convention this week. Four nights of celebration. Four nights of joy, which is what Democrats want us to talk about. Joy, and I know I can see it on all of your faces, joy is happening in your hearts right now. So we're going to call this segment Kamala Land, I think. No, we're not. Actually, Ben, you're in Chicago right now. You were there to attend the DNC. And as you mentioned, you also attended the RNC and you're like, what the hell am I doing here? So what I want to ask, are you doing in Chicago? I assume there's going to be like some drinking and drugs and like gambling or something. Was that what you ended up doing at the RNC? Tell us what you are hoping to get out of this. Why did you go to the DNC? What are you expecting?
I like going to them. I've been coming to the DNC since like the first one I went to was 2000. So, you know, I've been going to them. And then this was only the second RNC.
Do the math.
Yeah, I know.
going to them for 24 years.
Yeah, exactly. But so I don't know. I am one of the people, like all three of you, who spends too much time thinking about politics. And so
I'm so sorry.
I'm also a journalist, and these are some fun for journalists to all get together, and we get to, you know, share bad stories about the former editors we don't like and things like that to pass around. And then I also, though I am a Democrat, you know, and as we talked about, I have all these feelings, I don't actually like people who are activists that much. And so one of the things that I've always sort of enjoyed coming is to watch the zoo of these things, because it's something I have a hard time relating to, of like, putting on a sign and going and personally doing it.
You don't view signs as like essential items in your wardrobe?
No, there's no signs. I have a couple of shirts with words, but they're all from SoulCycle, and so it's gibberish. It's like, live well, fight. And you're like, oh, okay.
Those could be Kamala Harris slogans. Yeah, we're going to get to that in a minute, but like that's...
could be one.
The Venn diagram of Kamala Harris slogans and SoulCycle slogans is like, a circle.
I should have done a quiz.
2018, we had a soul cycle under my office in New York, and I went down to do a soul class on the night of the midterm election. And the writer, the teacher, who was like, everyone was very upset about Trump at the time, as you may remember. And they were like, we're going to win back the House tonight. And the teacher said, I just want everyone to know, you know, I want Trump to know that from everyone here in Chelsea, New York City, it's Trump's time to be afraid. And then we all like, you know, did a spin class. And I went upstairs and was like, all right, so the second that the results come in and they call the House or anything like that, the headline needs to be, it's your turn to be afraid, Trump. And so the overlap was 100% perfect. It sold well.
And that's why you're an internet genius, is you understood how to take what was said at your local Soul Cycle and put it on the, make it a headline and get people
very,
to click.
Tom Friedman does 2020s, right? It's, you know, it's, you don't talk to our cab drivers anymore. We talk to our Soul Cycle instructors. Wasn't Doug in Soul Cycle when Kamala was like elevated to the candidacy? There some headlines about like he was in a Soul Cycle class and he had left his phone in the car, and like he like got back to the car and there were like 40,000 texts that were like, where the fuck are you? I think that's right. I think he was in spin class while his wife was becoming
If you were a Democratic politician or politician spouse, you are always spinning. I want to talk about some of these slogans because there are four theme nights at the DNC this week, just like there were at the RNC. And so if you remember the RNC, there were, I forget the way they phrased them. There was some sort of like make America safe again, make America prosperous, something like that. But there were actual kind of like
deportation,
policy.
Deportation.
So we had basically it was like crime. We hate immigrants. Make the economy better. Cat ladies are bad. And then let's celebrate Donald Trump. But it was like some actual kind of policy issue areas. The four theme nights for the DNC are Monday, for the people. Tuesday, a bold vision for America's future. Wednesday, a fight for our freedoms. Okay. And then Thursday is for our future, which sounds an awful lot like the Tuesday theme to me. So one thing it seems like is they didn't really have enough themes to even go four nights. But I actually just want to ask you, Nick, about the Wednesday one, because this is kind of interesting to us, is that Kamala Harris,
I have already forgotten what the Wednesday night
a fight
was.
For our freedoms. A fight for our freedoms, because that is, in fact, something that Harris is really pushing here. She wants to be the candidate who owns the word freedom. She wants the Democratic Party to be the party that owns the concept of freedom. You are a libertarian. You are work at a libertarian magazine that cares a lot about freedom. How does that make you feel?
It always makes it feel good to see freedom being inserted into political rhetoric. One of her phrases also is, we're not going back. And there is that great video of 800-year-old people who I think might have been the Obama kids who sang for change in 2008, but have just preternaturally aged, playing a song called We're Not Going Back. We're like a tree that grows by the river. It is a thing of beauty to see. But the whole point of freedom, you know, I want to see more freedom. That is what we debate in America. What is freedom? Because freedom is the ultimate good. I don't see a lot of freedom rhetoric in Kamala Harris's, anything surrounding her. The way that people talk about it, it is kind of like the freedom to make other people live the way we think they should. It is the freedom to make people buy the stuff that we think they should, to the freedom to make businesses operate the way we think they should. There's a flip side of this on the Republican side when they start to talk about freedom, and their freedom froms are, you know, we want to make sure that we're free from anybody, anywhere, ever having an abortion. And I will just close this out that the most interesting use of freedom, probably at the DNC to date anyway, is a giant inflatable IUD, which is named, which is out there already, and it's called Frida Womb, is the name of the IUD.
The freedom to not watch the Democratic National Convention is a freedom.
That is
sadly
one many, many people will be exercising. Many real Americans will be exercising.
Not if we want to keep our jobs anyway.
You know, this is not a bad thing, right? To, you know, if people start talking about, you know, I, or rather, Part of the problem, I think, that goes to this question of just not being interested in talking to the center in American politics. And by that, I don't mean moderates or anything like that. I hate compromise candidates, but to the center, which is, you know, people like free enterprise, people like free speech, people, you know, want a vision of the future that is moving forward. And part of the problem with Harris is doing this, Biden did this, Hillary did this, Trump certainly did this. It is always about a backward-looking vision of like, you know what? I kind of fucking loved America when I was doing well, when I was in my 30s or my 20s or whatever. And so I'm going to recreate that. And that is such a failure a vision on the part of our politicians. What we need them to be talking about is how do they get out of the way? How do we clear the detritus of a massive regulatory state and of a massive top-down controlling, you know, neo-imperial America? How do we get rid of that, keep the bones of that society that makes sense? You know, and obviously from a libertarian point of view, that's things like free enterprise, freedom of speech, freedom of lifestyle choice, and more autonomy, more choices and more options in everything we do. And how do we make that happen for the future rather than saying, you know, what we really need to do is to put 20% imports on tariffs from China, you know, because that's bad, or that, you know, we're going to fuck over the sharing economy or make DoorDash even more expensive and make Uber and Airbnb impossible to function in large cities. So,
no, I just wanted to say that, like, I one of the things I was excited to talk about this with you guys is that, you know, I think that this is all empty rhetoric that you're saying, this freedom nonsense, but I like it too. And you people are the freedom people. That's your whole thing. You know, everyone has something, and that's what you guys do. And I feel like the fact that they're even saying it, even though it is empty, is a leading indicator of like a recognition in the changing winds of the popular sentiment and the political sentiment. You know, it's a few years ago that people started like use empty rhetoric that somehow it gave it moved the Democratic Party to the left. And like this, them talking about things in terms of freedom and liberty and the ability to do stuff is maybe only a word change right now, but it's a recognition that like the actual left-wing framing that just dominated stuff for the last decade or so was so utterly pathetic and repudiated by everyone that there's a shift in the normie sensibilities that you're talking about, Nick. And like, I think that's good for the Democratic Party to do that, to notice that. It's a good time.
This is a vibes election, and freedom is a vibe. And the freedom vibe does seem to be doing pretty well for Kamala Harris right now. She's closed the gap with Trump in a bunch of key states. Nate Silver's model currently says she has a slightly better than 50% shot at winning the election, at least if it were held today. The state of the race is very, very different than it was a month ago. Okay, so time for an ad. Have you heard about Senolytics yet? It's a class of ingredients discovered less than 10 years ago. They're being called the biggest discovery of our time for promoting healthy aging and enhancing your physical prime. Your life goals and your career, they require more than just productivity. But let's be honest, the aging process is not quite our friend when it comes to endless energy. That's why many people use Qualia Senolytic. Someone would have told the world that there are science-backed ingredients that could help people feel 15 months younger just in a matter of months. I think a lot of people wouldn't have believed it, but Qualia Senolytic, that's their promise. So as people age, everyone accumulates senescent cells in their body. Senescent cells cause symptoms of aging, aches and discomforts, slow workout recoveries. You know, you try that big lift and you're like, ugh, it feels terrible the next day. Sluggish mental and physical energy on a podcast associated with that middle-aged feeling. You get zombie cells, and zombies are bad in the movies and in your body. So all you have to do with this product is take it just 2 days a month. Qualia Senolytic can help you with higher energy levels, feeling 15 years younger, being more productive and enthusiastic in life, having fewer aches and pains, resisting aging at the cellular level. Try Qualia Senolytic. Go to qualialife.com/roundtable for up to 50% off and use code roundtable at checkout for an additional 15% off. Qualia Senolytic is also available at GNC locations near you. That's qualialife.com/roundtable for an extra 15% off your purchase. Thanks to Qualia for sponsoring today's episode. Okay, let's go to our listener question this week. It comes from Ray, and it's about Data, but sadly not the robot from Star Trek. So Ray writes, data collection on the part of private companies online is surprisingly complex. On the one hand, you could question, to what extent do people own certain information about themselves or the knowledge of such information? Your phone number. It's not necessarily yours, but simultaneously, it is uniquely identifiable information. There's laws like HIPAA, which Ray says are largely a good thing. Phone books have had do not call lists, but that doesn't stop calls from overseas and may even provide scammers with a list of accessible numbers to call. So what are our thoughts from a libertarian perspective on regulating data collection? Where does government fit in? Katherine, let's go to you first. Data collection, government regulation.
So I think we should always be focusing on strengthening the wall between the large piles of data that exist in the private sector and what the government can obtain. I don't think it's reasonable to say you can't collect data. For one thing, people are going to do it. For another thing, when private entities collect a lot of data, they are often using it for things that benefit us, right? Like, I am delighted to have, Amazon know more about me than my own mother because, I want Amazon to be like, hey, it's back to school time. Do you need a water bottle for your son? Because he can't keep a hold of his water bottles.
But also because you need to keep a lot of secrets from your mom. That you'll only share with Jeff Bezos.
No comments. But Jeff Bezos knows that my son needs a new water bottle, and I really appreciate that. So I think the place we have to try to hold the line is it's Tuesday, and Sheriff Asshole McGee is curious about me, and he starts, requesting or demanding private information about me from all of these companies. That's where things go bad. So I think, we cannot and should not try to create a world where we have, discourage the collection of this data and the use of this data. I think it makes the world better, but we should at least try to hold the line on making that information private from the government, except in cases where we have a warrant and where, some kind of genuine judicial oversight has been exercised. That's really hard. I recognize that what I just said is not super likely to happen. But I do think that is the place where our efforts would be best concentrated.
Ben, you were an internet guru at Mother Jones for a while. You used a lot of data about people to figure out how to run Mother Jones's website. How do you feel about this?
I agree with everything Katherine just said. Before Mother Jones, I worked at CNET, so I used to use that data to sell people cell phones. And that's the thing, is that it's cell phones and politics. You're all selling something. But you use data to do it, and it makes it all so much more money. I've always, the thing about my data concerns are exactly the ones where it becomes law enforcement has access to it. I genuinely could not care less if these stupid apps have anonymized data about me. That it's just going to help them give me better ads. The ads are great. I love those ads. Thank God. It's so nice.
You just bought a couch. Do you want to buy another couch? You just bought two couches. Do you want to buy a third couch?
Exactly. No. It's handing me the couches, and it says you know what? You should do one over there too. And I go, I've never looked at that part of the room. I could put a couch there.
At that part of the room and see what the couch would look like in it.
And I can sit on it and look back at the other couch. But then the other thing is that when you imagine someone on who you want on your team, I want these guys, whoever came up with this idea of just making a business plan for these free apps by taking my data, I want those people on my team. Those are innovators. That's how we got to the moon, baby, And otherwise you're Europe and they're giving you those stupid pop-ups about cookies. I don't give a shit about these cookies. Do whatever you want with my cookies. But then it would be really bad if law enforcement was able to find out that, what pornography I watch and things like that.
You put that on Twitter, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's why you have to send the misdirection on Twitter as well. You have to, look over here. You never know. I agree with everything we just said.
Nick, thoughts about government regulation of data collection?
To build on what Ben was saying, I remember the time, this going back to about 2008 or 9, we ran a documentary about a Reason contributor, actually, whose father was killed in a gulag. His name was John Utley. And there was this great film where he, after the Soviet archives were opened briefly in the early 90s, he went to see what had actually happened because he had never known. He had never been told exactly what happened. So we ran this beautiful, heartbreaking documentary about, you know, where it ends with him in near the Arctic Circle on the site of the old Vorkuta concentration camp gulag, where his father was just killed in a mass shooting one day. And it was immediately after that, the website for about 6 weeks was surrounded only with ads for Russian brides. Because in the early pre knowing how to really mine data with any specificity, it assumed Reason.com was into Russian stuff. So, of course, all of our readers would want Russian brides. And this is a sign of how far we go, that now, Peter, when you get your Russian brides stuff, it's going only to you and not to the rest of the Reason team. All have our particularities like that.
There was a guy who and we're all very sorry. I'm going to interrupt you just for a second. At Monday Jones, there was a bunch of like people who were all very pro-Palestinian, but they were also gay. And there are a lot of gay liberals who were getting these ads for Tel Aviv as a gay place to go because it's number one spot in the world for gay tourism, I guess. And so you could see these wonderful things of them being like, how is this happening? I mean, the Jews, though?
The Jews have figured it out. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can only imagine what kind of ads Candace Owens is getting these days. Right.
Yeah. This is actually something that happens all the time. And I guess I'll put this out as like a PSA to our podcast listeners. Like, don't email the publications that you love and complain about the ads on the website anymore. Because truly, you are now just telling on yourself. Like, back in the day of this John Utley documentary, yes. Oh, there's all these ads for Russian brides. This is weird. What's going on? Reason is a fair question. Now, hey, why am I getting all these ads for like erectile dysfunction drugs? I don't know, buddy. Why are you? You tell me.
I will just say that the personalization does leave something to be desired. Because
absolutely. But it is so much better. And just the broader point is that, yes, we need to keep checks on what government can do with data that is being compiled. There are probably times when corporations or businesses and websites are taking this information without your express permission, blah, 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 whatever. Those tend to be very, very minor. What happens is, that the Social Security Administration gets hacked. And that's a treasure trove of all kinds of information. And we know the government sucks more at protecting our information, than private businesses who can be sued, et cetera. But there is also a general upside to the networked information that we have. And that is worth, it doesn't mean everybody gets a clean slate and everything, but let's not get to a point where we're only focusing on issues with data privacy rather than putting it in a larger context of like, overall, it makes the world a lot better.
I have been purchasing clothes from Banana Republic online for at least 15 years. I have only ever purchased men's clothes, I swear. And yet, Banana Republic's advertising system is absolutely laboring under the impression that I really want this year's dresses and skirts. And they have been laboring under that impression for over a decade. I don't think I have ever gotten an email for men's clothes from Banana Republic, despite purchasing multiple orders per year for over a decade of exclusively men's clothes.
Peter, your phone just heard you say Banana Republic dresses and skirts, and you've made the problem infinitely worse now. I hope you know.
All right. That's a good transition. We do need to move on here. So since Katherine brought up making problems infinitely worse, we're going to talk about the Republican candidate in the race here, Donald Trump. Trump also gave an economic speech recently. And while a lot of it was meandering and not really related to economic policy, like I said, bipartisanship, not dead. He did make two arguments I want to address here. So first, he gave Biden and Harris, he gave Biden and Harris an economic miracle, basically just glossing over 2020. Who was president in 2020? No one really knows, but what the hell. So second, Trump said he would make the economy great again with a massive, all-encompassing system of tariffs. Previously, he has said that the sort of overall tariff would be 10%. Last week, he said it might be 20%. We're going to call this segment Free Trade Isn't Free, but it is short. So, Katherine, all around 20% tariff, what would that do to the economy? Please use little words so that I can understand.
Not great stuff, my friend. I was reading USA Today's coverage of this, which is our nation's source for things explained in little words. And it was actually an incredible, the person hardest hit by Trump's tax and specifically tariff proposals. I think we found him, and it is Garrett Watson at the Tax Foundation, who USA Today called him and was like, what's going on? And among other things, he there's kind of some basic analysis. Okay, you know, Moody's says a 10% tariff would lead to 2 million fewer U.S. jobs and a 1.7% smaller economy by 2028. That would be worse, I guess, if it's 20%, but we didn't have time to model this again because Trump just keeps changing his plans in the middle of speeches. There's a little quote at the end of the piece, though. It's unclear what the guiding principle here is, like where these numbers are coming from, Watson said. Is it an effort to offset other tax changes, or is it just what sounds good to folks who are supporting these tariffs? That would be a big question. And that's the kicker of the piece. And where's the lie? He's right. Those are good questions.
Katherine, I'm actually not going to file any original copy for the rest of the year. I'm just going to program something to say what a politician said and then write, it's unclear what the guiding principle is. And that's it. That's all. That's the rest. That's all you get for me.
The suitor bot can take over.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, Ben, this sort of brings us back to Harris. We were pretty mean to Harris's agenda. I don't think we said really much of anything nice about it. But there was one line in her speech that I thought was pretty good, and it was when she criticized Trump's tariffs. She said, it's effectively a national sales tax on everyday products and basic necessities. Right? This fits into her message. Like, Trump is going to raise the cost of living, which you're already mad about being too high. It seems good, right? But the problem, I think, is that the Biden administration kept the majority of Trump's original tariffs in place and actually added to the pile of tariffs and increasing tariffs, you know, on EVs, stuff from China. Is this a case of your tariffs are bad, but mine are good, actually? Why aren't the Biden administration's tariffs bad, too?
I think that the fact that they kept those tariffs was always a complicating factor to this talking point. Even, like, while it was a bad policy when they did it, when Trump did it, when they kept it, when the Biden people kept it. And it does sort of complicate them running on this obvious message that every economist wants to have a nervous breakdown, hearing them talk about tariffs like they're not taxes on everyday things. I don't know why they kept those tariffs. It's upsetting. It's bad. It is 100% hypocritical. And what you said of their tariffs being good and your tariffs being bad, and it unprincipled and terrible. But you know who's also bad? That Donald Trump.
That's. The 20% all around, yes, is much worse than what the Biden administration has in place. Like it is fair to say that what Trump is talking about, to the extent we have a real clear sense of what it would be like if he actually did that, it would be worse than the current situation under Biden in terms of trade and tariffs.
I'll give Donald Trump a few things in life. You know, I think he's a funny guy. They don't give him a credit for the funny. He's got a good
like you. He started without a head start in life, right?
Right, right.
Not enough.
People don't
give
him credit. Yeah. They don't realize that he's still the hero of his own story. He doesn't feel like his life was perfect. There's a few things he's done some all right stuff, but the other thing, he's right about the water pressure and the showers. but the other thing is that, like, I will give him 100% credit that he truly believes this tariff nonsense. You know, this is not him. He's not pulling the Kamala just saying stuff. He's been obsessed with tariffs since the day he came down that golden escalator. And he knows in his heart, whatever happened when he was young, tariffs did the murder. And he is after it. Whereas Kamala Harris, I don't think, has an opinion about this at all. And possibly the most recent person to speak to her is the one she is repeating, and since they're such bad policies and so stupid, I'd rather have the dilettante who's just repeating it than the true believer who really has decided that, it was the tariff in the kitchen with the knife.
There's a way in which the best thing you can say about Kamala Harris is that she has a long history of proposing things that she clearly doesn't really care about or maybe even fully understand, and then just abandoning those ideas when they are politically inconvenient. But that's maybe not a good reason to vote for someone. I don't know. It seems like that's also bad. But yes, there is a gap, I think, between Harris's commitment to some of these ideas and Trump's particular commitment to trade policy. Nick, the 20% tariffs, the 10% tariffs. Donald Trump is, you know, this is all part of Donald Trump's argument that, like, actually his economy was great. And certainly it is true that at the end of 2019, early 2020, like, the economy had a lot going for it and people were pretty happy with it. How do you process this argument between the two candidates about who would be best for the economy?
I find it amazing because, you know, according to polls, most people think Donald Trump would be better for the economy. So that in some
way, Harris has closed that gap recently. Like, she's closer than Biden was.
I agree with that, or I know that, and I suspect that the more she talks, that gap will start to either stay the same or grow a little bit. I think the reason for that is that people trust Trump as a businessman, even if, you know, you can call him a fake billionaire and all of that kind of stuff. And there's a lot of merit to that. But he does seem to understand business from the point of view of trying to run a business and create jobs and fire people, you know, for sport and things like that. And I think the difference is, and, you know, Matt, you know, bless his absence today, has written about this and other people at Reason. Trump was not the deregulator he claimed to be, but there is no question that if there are 100 knobs that the federal government can turn to, you know, screw down the economy or open it up a little bit, Trump as a regulator was very loose on that. And I think that's what people are responding to, is the fact that Trump will say, fuck it, let more things happen rather than fewer things. And that's what people are banking on. You know, the issue of tariffs is ridiculous, and what he is proposing is ridiculous. What he proposes about immigration, for the most part, is absolutely not just morally bankrupt, but economically idiotic beyond belief. But he does have, you know, the track record of while he was in office before COVID, and we need to talk. I mean, if I was a Democrat, I would talk more about his COVID policies, because most of the worst things, like the lockdown, you know, were pushed by him, et cetera. I think it makes sense that he has better standing with the public on the economy, because he seems to understand it better. And things went well under him in a way that I think nobody really trusted Biden. I don't think anybody really trusts Harris on the economy.
Very briefly, though, this is also just this. It's just the same. It's the high variability versus predictably bad thing, right? Like, we know basically what Harris would do. She would push things in a more regulatory, more progressive, more redistributivist, big government direction, you know, in whatever way she could, which depends on the balance of Congress. Trump might really do whole-scale trade war with China, for reals, for reals. But
he also might just watch Fox News all day.
Or he might just watch Fox News. Well, it's variability.
He governed pretty moderately on a lot of economic stuff. So he's a paper tiger, and I think people understand.
I don't think we can rely on that in his second term. I think that is the biggest question, is like, which of the Trump hobby horses do we ride into the apocalypse? and it might be the China one. And if it is, that's going to have really, really severe economic consequences. Beyond what anybody's really talking about. Sorry.
It just is remarkable that especially over the last week, we've seen the emergence of both sides basically arguing that their candidates would be better because they won't do the things that they're proposing to do to the economy. This is just not a great situation to be in, but here we are. This is the life we have chosen. All right, so let's go to our final segment here, What You Watching, What You Consuming, in which we talk about some piece of media that we have engaged with over the last week or so. Katherine, let's start with you.
I have my book right here, as it happens. I read The Last Murder at the End of the World by Stuart Turton. And it's good. I really recommend it as a beach read, but it's a beach read that won't make you feel embarrassed afterward. And I think that's a really important criteria in the beach read.
Don't be embarrassed by the books you read.
If you're not reading at least one book you wouldn't admit to reading in public occasionally, you're doing it wrong. So this is the author. You might know his name from the book, The 7.5 Deaths of Evelyn Hardcastle. This one is a different genre. I would say it's a dystopian science fiction novel that is also a Holmesian locked room murder mystery that has philosophical overtones.
I'm sorry, was this book written very specifically for each member of this podcast?
Yes, yes it was. Okay. And I appreciate that Stuart went to all that trouble for us. There is in fact a third thing, a twist, which I will not reveal because you should discover it for yourself on the beach or poolside or just hiding under your covers with a flashlight. This book is light and fluffy feeling while also having substance. So The Last Murder at the End of the World.
Ben, what are you not embarrassed to be reading or watching?
I read the Scott Turow book, Personal Injuries, which is from the 90s. But I was watching the
same guy who wrote Presumed Innocent, right? The novel.
Right. So that's why I ended up, I was then going down his hole, you know, of all of the books from the 90s. And it's about, you know, government coercion and there's a lawyer.
Nick, don't even.
And all of this.
You said you were going down his hole and Nick just couldn't help himself.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I usually have a very low disgust reflex, but for some reason, Scott Turow's hoe made me flinch. I apologize.
I heard that he isn't a terribly nice person in the world. Did you guys fall out of love once, Summer, in Maine?
No. What did you like about the book?
I liked that, I like books that do, I like legal thrillers because I don't know enough about law to really, the dream of everyone in the world is that you get to go to a movie or read a book and then you get to walk out and say, like, you know, dentistry isn't really that interesting. I'm a dentist. And like with journalism, it's always boring. They always have a solving crimes and so like, you know, solving like the train crashed, but it was the drug company did it. But we're going to fall in love with the competing reporter on the case. It's all bullshit. All we do is blog.
I want to point out that the Girl with Dragon Tattoo series is about a political magazine editor, and he nailed it. That was my life for at least 4 or 5 years.
The greatest realism of that series is the very specific descriptions of each Mac product that he buys. Do you remember
and
that?
And the Billy pizza. Yeah, no, it was always, with this chip, not that other chip, because it wasn't really very good while you're tracking down international sex traffickers.
Okay, I take it back. You guys should be embarrassed by having read those books.
Yeah. But this one is about like an ambulance chasing attorney, and he's bribing the judges, but the FBI needs help bringing him down. And you know, I have no idea if any of this is legit or how this would go down. Doesn't sound like it. Doesn't seem like how I would run my FBI squad if I was doing it. But it's compelling stuff, and you go, all right, I'm learning about it. It's like watching The Practice where you suddenly think you can then be a good defense attorney because like they have plan B in The Practice. But I love it. I love this thing.
I do love a 1990s thriller. Nick, what have you been consuming?
Well, I watched something. I watched something, Katherine, that you would particularly enjoy called Wild, Wild Space. It's a documentary on HBO or on Max now, whatever it's being called. And I want to read the capsule summary that came up in an AI summary, which it seems like they trained the AI on the old movie critic Gene Shalit, who always gave everything like 6 stars out of 4. In a nutshell, epic, nail-biting, and fascinating. But this is, it looks at two companies, one by a self-made experimenter, tinkerer, seemingly from the 19th century in New Zealand, who builds a company out of almost nothing, and then a Silicon Valley would-be, you know, a master of the universe, who's trying to launch rockets that would really compete with Tesla or with SpaceX and things like that. And obviously it's on the side of the tinkerer who ends up doing a lot of stuff to launch low orbit satellites so that you can view a lot of stuff all over the planet. And there's a ton of use for that in all sorts of commercial applications, surveillance applications, you name it. It's a fascinating story about what the future of space exploration is probably going to look like, which is less whiz-bang stuff like we're getting into our sleep pods and we're going to wake up and, you know, start a spin cycle franchise on Alpha Centauri in 600 light years. And it's more like we're just going to have a hovering, you know, kind of cloud of junk satellites doing all sorts of really interesting shit all the time that make our lives much easier here on Earth. And in a way, Starlink is an early emanation of that. And that changes a lot of things. But Wild Wild Space is really interesting. I mean, it's a very well done documentary with, you know, heroes and villains and everything in between, a lot of strange characters. But mostly what I found compelling about it was that it showed what space is probably going to be like in the next 10 to 25 years before we get into the, you know, kind of like interstellar world or 2001 A Space Odyssey.
So
are they even working on that space pod thing? Because we're going to need that at some point. Like that's whenever they do these things, it always seems that the hibernation problem.
You know, I think they've the main company doing that diverted into lactation booths at airports now. So it might be a while.
I never need to hibernate more than I need to hibernate right now. Honestly,
this question was
you'd
very
never
specifically...
want to be in the space pod. You know, like they have a failure rate of at least 50% in every movie.
I don't need to go to space. I just don't want to be awake for this.
Yeah, I know. I get that. I'm just saying.
We need a hibernation pod just for the last 15
Someone
minutes
can carefully of the podcast me yeah. while I'm sleeping.
So this question was very specifically addressed in my recommendation or quasi-recommendation, which is Alien Romulus. It is the latest film in the Alien series that has been going since 1979. And the very first movie opens with a spaceship kind of waking up and people coming out of their hibernation cryopods. And this film is about a group of like angsty teen mining laborers who are trying to steal a cryopod so they can get out of get out from under the thumb of the big corporation that is just keeping them down and extending their contracts. Like they can never, like basically slaves to Weyland Yutani. And they want to steal this mining, this pod so that they can go to another planet that's like a 9-year flight away or space flight away. But of course they go to a space station that is supposedly abandoned and it's not. It's the movie is titled Alien Romulus and there are aliens there and they kill a lot of people. And the movie basically just quotes all of the alien movies that came before it. It is like a collage or a pastiche of scenes that you have seen before, including a huge amount of just straight up ripped off stuff from the third act of Aliens with the elevator, some dialogue that is directly lifted from Aliens and some of these other movies, a third act twist that is almost exactly the third act twist of Alien Resurrection. Not that you've seen that one. The first 30 minutes or so are just like, what if we actually showed you what life was like on that mining colony that they go to in Aliens? And then also, but with the industrial aesthetic of Alien 3, it's really like all of the, what I think the Alien movies are a little bit of a mixed bag in terms of like overall quality. The first two are phenomenal. I really love the third one. No one else does. I think the fourth one is really interesting just as a sort of like art object. But what's great about all of those movies is they all had interesting sociological ideas. They were all kind of about their political economic context. The first one is very particularly about like the labor politics of the late 1970s Britain. I mean, it's kind of a fascinating artifact. And this movie isn't about anything except how the other Alien movies are really cool. And that's true. The Alien movies are super cool. And this movie kind of works on that level, but it just doesn't have anything at all that is new to say besides, you know, you really loved the Alien movies and you've seen them a whole lot of times. And yes, I have seen them a whole lot of times, but I didn't want to see them all mashed up into one movie again. And that's what this is. So I guess I recommend it if you can't help yourself and need to see Alien
if
movies
you
because
have
they're
a problem.
Out.
Let me ask you a question about these aliens. Because I think that it would be easy to kill the alien. You know? No. You shoot it in the head.
I think that's wrong, Ben. What you need to do is sit down and talk to it. You know, and you got to treat it with respect.
In the second one, there's an 8-year-old girl who lives in like, outsmarts them by hiding in an air conditioning unit for a year. Like, these aren't outside
of the
box.
It's like 6 months.
These guys aren't monetizing your data, okay? These are stupid little animals. Humans kill things like this by accident.
I mean, it's very It's very funny that the series, the big bads are kind of the aliens, but it's always really behind the aliens is the big corporation that is just runs everything. Like, it's weirdly kind of synonymous with a Kamala Harris, you know, Lena Khan antitrust view of like a sort of modern progressive Democrat view of like the real problem is just greedflation. They just want to take those aliens and make money off of them. When don't they realize those aliens are trying to kill everybody and they've got acid for blood, which is in fact the reason that you can't just shoot them. I would love to do a full hour just on the Alien franchise with you, Ben, but we are out of time. So I just, before we go, I want to ask Ben, where can people find you? What should people do to subscribe to your products and like engage with Ben Dreyfuss on the internet?
And by the way, saying where can people find you is just the inverse of saying where can people avoid you?
Ben. Right. No. Yeah. Well, in public, there are so many places they can avoid me. But online, they can find me at calmdownben.com or bendreyfuss.com. Because
you
I
got
both.
Wow.
Yeah. And or you can find me at my name at anywhere, because my entire life I've always been very good about getting the username before those other Ben Dreyfusses, bastards. And you should, because money pays for goods and services, and I love goods and services. But yes, thank you guys for having me.
Yeah,
thank you so much for
it's
being
a,
here. I'm
tremendous,
glad that you have
tremendous Substack that you have, Ben, or regular column. I don't know what you call it, but it's very good.
I call it a Substack.
It's the Twitter presence is magnificent. It makes that site great.
It's a delight because it is entirely too much. And that's the whole point of it. And I appreciate every word of the too muchness. Before we go, Nick, do we have any events we want to advertise? Anything coming up that you want to talk about on the TV side or in New York happening here?
Yeah, I do. On September 11th, Wednesday, September 11th, we're going to make that day great again by having a Reason Speakeasy with Kat Timpf, who's got a new book out. Go to reason.com/events to get information and tickets about that. The Reason Speakeasy is a monthly gathering of people who are just interested in free speech and fun conversation with interesting people. Come on out. Go to reason.com/events to find out what we're up to all over the place.
All right, that'll do it for this week. Thank you so much, Ben. Subscribe to his Substack. Come to our events, read Reason.com. And you can also give us your money at Reason.com/donate. That's Reason.com/donate. It helps helps us pay for all of the fun things that we do, including this podcast. That is it. Matt Welch will be back next week. Look for his dispatches from the Democratic National Convention. What's your